Yes, it's quite a collection of stars of the Green Bays, isn't it? Because no fewer than 7 former winners of this Travis Perkins UK Championship started out this week in York. We'll be seeing 2 of them, the defending champion Mark Williams and Stephen Hendry, in this programme. But first, let's catch up with the progress of another couple of former title holders, John Higgins and first Ronnie O'Sullivan. The Rocket was irrepressible this afternoon against a bewildered Ian McCulloch of Preston. This black for a 140 clearance gave O'Sullivan the highest televised break of the week and put him 3-0 ahead. It seemed the only way he could lose was by beating himself. But even left-handed, there was no overstretching. His shot selection was excellent, as was his pot success rate, a phenomenal 97%. He knocked in 7 breaks of over 50 and leads 7-1. James Wattenau was in similarly inspired form at the start of his game. He raced to a flamboyant 4-0 lead with John Higgins, an innocent bystander. The halftime cuppa seemed to revitalise John, and he closed to 4-3. Wattenau couldn't believe what he was seeing, but then in the 8th frame, the Scot missed the decisive red. Typhoon breezed through the colours and blew himself into a 5-3 overnight lead.
Thank you, Sue, in the frame. James Wattenau. Thanks, John.
So how does all of that affect the championship draw? Well, the defending champion Mark Williams has a tough match on his hands against Dublin's Fergal O'Brien. Joe Perry has a date with Bond, Nigel Bond. He's coming back to form, of course. Paul Hunter, a big hit on superstars, but this is an event which he's got a far better chance of winning. Double Masters champion plays Mark King. As we've seen, James Wattenau has the slight advantage over John Higgins. They finish tomorrow. And Ronnie O'Sullivan looks in no mood to hang about in his contest either. For one of those, Alan McManus is next. Now, understandably, Australia's Quinton Hahn has been keeping a low profile today. He'll meet former world champ Peter Ebdon. Barry Pinches is the surprise name in the 3rd round. He now plays the world number 5, Stephen Lee. And 2 ex-UK title holders, John Parrott and Stephen Hendry, square up for the right to play young Ali Carter. And we've been joined on the night shift here by Dennis Taylor. Is there any truth in the rumour, Dennis, that as an Irishman, you're the only one sober enough here that you haven't been drinking all day after England's World Cup victory?
I don't think I was fit to drink. I drove back through the night from Lowestoft so as I'd be able to watch the rugby this morning, and it was fantastic. Yes. They did really well.
Yes, yeah. I think we should all raise a glass. Congratulations to them. But what does that draw throw up for you in terms of the progress of some of the former champions?
Well, just looking at Ronnie, I mean, that's a good result, 7-1 against Ian McCulloch. Ian's a difficult opponent, so Ronnie's looking good. John Higgins has got a match in his hands. Still think he might come through that one, but the way James played in the first 4 frames was terrific. Nice to see him back playing well again, but John should have nicked it. He should have levelled it at 4 each there, so it's all getting up nicely. The UK, all the players get themselves up for this one. And they were all playing terrific in the last tournament anyway, so we're in for a treat here.
I think we are, Dennis. You're going to stay with us through the witching hour, so thank you very much for being with us tonight. But in case you're just getting back in from the pub after a day of celebrations, it's time to show you what's been happening here in York. We're going to start with the defending champion, Mark Williams. And he was up against a real dogged opponent from Dublin. They don't call him Fearless Fergal O'Brien for nothing, you know.
Death of my career have been greatly exaggerated, so I'm back better than ever. Slipping out of the tourney today, that's probably as low as I can really go. So it was just from there, a lot freer now, a lot happier with myself. I'm just trying to enjoy it a little bit more and just being a lot more positive. I love the game, so I wasn't going to walk away. So if it means I'm 33 in the world, I've got to go to Verstappen and qualify to get to venues, well, so be it. You know, I've no divine right to be in the 16 or 32. I'm 33 because I didn't win enough matches. So, as I said, I love the game, decided to come back, and, you know, come back better than ever. feel like my game has been building up to this match. You know, if I'm playing well, I've got a few wins. So, you know, if given the choice, I'd pick the 17 because I want to pit my wits against Mark, the world champion, give him my best game and see how I get on. And when I lose, you can, you know, go on from strength from there. I think it's not a question of who I am, it's more who I can become.
Door keeps turning.
Now, Fergal couldn't have it tougher today against the world number one, who began a stellar year by taking this title 12 months ago. There was no stopping Mark Williams after that. He went on to take the B&H Masters at Wembley. Then, the big one. At the Crucible, the Welshman was crowned world champion for the second time. And only last month in Preston, Mark completed the BBC Slam, winning all of our televised tournaments in the season-opening LG Cup. But how would he fare today? The defending champion made an impressive start, taking the first frame with a break of 103. But in the following frame, Williams stayed in his chair as O'Brien even matters at 1-1. The luck of the Irish was evident as O'Brien took the third. And then he opened up a two-frame lead with a classy century break to make it 3-1 at the mid-session. After the break, Williams pulled the frame back to trail 2-3 when O'Brien went in off. Some precision long potting from both players kept the gap between them to a single frame. In the final frame of the session, the luck seemed firmly on the Welshman's side. And after some cute safety play from both, O'Brien's frustration was compounded when he went in off once again, allowing Williams to draw level at 4-4. Well, 4-all became 6-all, and we are now in frame 13 tonight. It's Williams to play, trailing by 20 points with just the colours remaining. Clive Everton and John Virgo calling the shots.
That's a better shot from Mark Williams. Easy maybe to get round the brown, as you see with the swerve shot, but he really won't be able to control the yellow.
Foul and a miss. Mark Williams.
So a 7-point penalty takes Mark Williams just 13 behind. And miscalled. He's so near the brown that if he tries to play this with the pace that he did, he really can't get the swerve in quick enough, I don't think. He's got to play it a little slower to get round the brown. Yeah. On the evidence of the last shot. Most unusually in a match where Mark Williams is concerned, we've had some pretty long frames in this match. a 46-minute frame, the eighth. Two frames in the first session over 25 minutes, and a 36-minute frame, the one before the interval, and now we're just coming to 30 minutes again. So, most unusual. Moment, there's no fluency in the play of either player. Half a chance, but is there an angle on the yellow to get to the right hand side of the table for the green? Just about, I think.
Two.
But very difficult to avoid the blue here, and the cue ball could go pretty well anywhere from this.
Five.
And all things being equal, that's not bad.
Well, that puts nine. Williams now 4 points behind, so he still needs blue, pink and the black. To be straight on 40. This pink, he's not. Pots the pink, he goes 7 points in front. I don't think he can get close to the black. And no matter what happens, he can't afford to miss the pink. Big frame now this. Fergal O'Brien's had his chances. Will he get another one? Not there. Well, would you believe it?
Not Williams 40.
So Fergal O'Brien does get another chance. He needs pink and he needs the black.
Six.
Well, he could have left it a little easier, but I think Mark Williams will rue that to Miss Pink. Fergal O'Brien finally knocks the black in. Goes back into the lead at 7 frames to 6.
Yes, a real slow burner this match. That frame took 33 minutes to complete, and the defending champion knows that he has got a scrap on his hands. Remember, first to nine will go through. Well, it's tight again in frame 14. The Irishman at the table.
Well, now, this red will pot. Can he get past the pink? I don't think so, the way he's shaking his head. Well, certainly without swerving it, he can't pot that. Can hit the edge. And did swerve it with a lot of left-hand side.
One.
But the same problem as when he potted the last red. There's no real benefit in taking a colour on.
Mark Williams won.
And I think that's pretty sensible. He didn't try to snooker Fergal on these two reds. He definitely wants him to try and play a shot with a bit of pace in and bring them into play. Fergal wasn't going to be kidded. He played it well.
Not as well as that, though. Excellent snooker. Oh, has he got the pace to hit them off the top cushion? Has he got the pace?
Oh, and a miss. Mark Williams fall.
Well, he had the line. So you wouldn't expect him to miss it this time. All these points are vital now, though. A similar shot, doesn't really matter, it's just the pace he was short of. I think he's got the pace this time. I was going to say, he made that shot look easy last time, you know, and it wasn't as easy as that. And this time, he's opened the reds, not even got near the balk line. Another chance for Fergal O'Brien. You see, lots of problems. One. The green is the main one. But he's come nicely on the pink. Just roll this in, leave the cue ball on the right-hand side of the table. Glance at the scoreboard, he's 2 points behind. Mark Williams has made another unforced error. Will this one cost him the frame?
Well, Fergal's got the perfect angle on the pink. Just screw down to the left of the black. If he leaves the cue ball on that side cushion, he's got an outside chance of finding an angle to nudge the green out, but he's still got the problem of the brown.
Yeah, well, I was just thinking, the shot you're saying, Ray, why doesn't he stun off to that side cushion just past the middle and try to cannon the brown into play? He's trying to cannon the green into play. Say, if he cannons the brown into play, then he's only got one awkward ball. Look to have a natural angle to attempt that. Another glance at the scoreboard. It's amazing when you're nervous. You have to keep looking at it after every shot. Has he got the cannon this time? Yes. Not really knocked it on too nicely for the pot. Is he going to have another look at the scoreboard? He is.
Mystifying me a bit as to where he's looking there, John. He's going to roll this green in steady to this corner. It'll be some shot.
Well, he's had plenty of easier chances than this. Maybe he's thinking grass the nettle. Not there.
Fergal O'Brien, 60.
And it doesn't look particularly safe. Although, I'll once again refer to Mark's form so far this evening. This is no certainty.
Three.
He knocked it in nicely. Brown, though, just as difficult.
Well, he's produced two seven. Very good shots just when he needed them. And a nice angle on the blue to come for the pink, which is all he needs. But he's flirting with danger, Mark Williams. Fergal O'Brien had two or three half chances there. He didn't take them. So the Welshman, still well below his best, levels again at 7 frames each.
Yes, and Williams is really having to work hard out there because he's protecting not just the defence of his UK title here, but he's also trying to protect the most remarkable record, because it's over 5 years since the Welshman last lost in his opening match in a major tournament. But he is in trouble again, big trouble, in frame 15.
One.
So, two more reds after the blue. Easily available, the next four. Somewhat more awkward.
Six. Seven.
Well, his position will play again far from the quality to which we're accustomed from Mark.
Forty.
He's still on the pink to the middle, but where's the next red coming from?
Well, I'm just wondering, Ray, does the pink go into the left middle? Well, it does. As you say, where's the next red come from? Nice. He's played for the double. The red near the right-hand side cushion into the left centre.
20.
He does like a double. But not to be.
20.
Please close the points gap somewhat. Just 15 points behind now, Mark Williams.
One. Mark Williams, one.
Well, just come off the right table, just to, got to avoid the blue. Pretty good. Couldn't have hoped for much better than that.
One.
A successful double, but no position on the colour. 15 points in front. Will he go for the extra 7 points for the black? Or will he just run off the black thin and leave the cue ball somewhere about where he's pointing his cue now? That seems to be his options. Well, he's going to play it off the brown or the blue then to get in the jaws of that far right corner pocket. I could think of easier shots to play.
Yeah, I don't think he could play it off the blue because that's one of the balls that he'd be hoping would be in the way. But if he does play thin off the black, he's just going to knock it over the corner pocket, so it's not quite straightforward. He's taking the green, I think, more trying to knock it to the but sacrificed covering to the left, trying to put the green out of play. And well, Matt Williams' long potting was not brilliant this evening. There's nothing wrong with that one though.
One.
Decision time.
Yes, he should never have been left that red. I'll take your point, Ray, if he went thin off the black, he'd knock it over the corner pocket, but if he'd have got the snooker on the red near the left corner pocket, then that'd have been to his advantage. I don't think this red will double. But he's played a good snooker. Favourite in this frame.
Looks held. Could have gone anywhere the red, he'll be delighted where it finished. Oh, another fine shot though from Matt Williams. And this one, not quite so easy to hit. I don't think he can go off two cushions, although he's playing it off two. He's going to miss the green. Go around the back of the green. I didn't think the angle was on, and it could well be a free ball.
And a miss. Mark Williams, four. Free ball.
That could be expensive.
Yes, I suppose the only obstacle in Mark's way. The points are level now. That counts as a red. Nicely on the blue. He's getting from yellow to green.
One.
And I can't say that Fergal O'Brien will be kicking himself. The chances he's missed in this frame. If he was kicking
six.
Himself, the chances he's missed in the match, he'd be black and blue.
Seven.
But that's a poor shot from Mark.
Mark Williams, sir.
Well, he's got good position, but really and truthfully, you'd expect him to knock this blue in. It's into the wide part of the pocket. Well, he could have left this more awkward, but not a lot. He's stretching over the blue. It's the blind pocket pot, as we call it, which means your eyes are, the cue is going away from the pocket that you're trying to knock the ball in. He may not even take it on. We'll see. Well, he wants to take it on, but by the time he gets round to taking it, I think he'll have got fed up of the studying and how awkward it is.
Yes, and the other problem, of course, when you're so busy trying to get the rest dead in, wondering about touching the blue, you don't really see the potting angle. And he needs to pot this green if he goes for it. It was difficult, difficult. Now, will this green squeeze past the blue? I don't think it will, but a double may be on. It's there, but he's not on the brown. Well, he's on the brown, but just resting on it. No way he can pot it. Frame's still in the balance.
Mark Williams, 3.
We'd have to say, under normal circumstances, the player who gets the brown will win the frame with the blue being over the pocket, but things are far from normal with these two this evening.
Risky. Has he got behind the black? Just. Good shot.
I think Mark can comfortably get to the side cushion and get the angle behind the brown, but he needs to hit it pretty full in the face, just off full, to try and knock it down towards the black off two cushions.
Yeah, pace is all important, isn't it, with this shot as well. We'll knock it over the corner pocket. And it's heading that way. It's heading that way. This is a chance. How many times have I said that in this frame?
A good clean pot, and really he can't miss the blue. All about judgment of pace now. off this end cushion.
Yes, and he needs the three remaining colours. But I agree with you, Ray. This is the key shot. Blue position on the pink.
Nine.
Inch perfect.
Mark Williams has had chances. Many of them. There's only two frames left. After this, Fergal knocks the black in then. The Welshman needs both of them. In it goes. So a very relieved Irishman takes a one frame lead over the Welshman. 8-7. Fergal O'Brien.
Yes, and psychologically such an important frame for the 33-year-old Dubliner to win because it puts him on the verge of a major upset, and it's the defending champion Mark Williams who is having to shoulder the pressure from the real discomfort of his chair in frame 16 now.
Well, what on earth was that? That was quite
Fergal O'Brien.
Well, it was a kick, I don't know what.
No, it was a miscue, Ray. He's miscued. He must have done. You can't miss a shot by that far.
One.
But what an opportunity he's let go there. Dear me. Oh, and he gets another one.
Mark Williams, what?
This is remarkable. Simple, black off the spot. UK champion, world champion. Back against the wall. What? You wouldn't expect him to miss a black like that.
Well, his reputation is that when the going gets tough, he really gets going, but that's not the case so far in this match at all, is it?
No, certainly isn't. Not quite hard enough, I don't think, on this red. He wanted to be straight on it, just to roll it in. He's played that well.
Nine.
He's played that well. Never easy to judge. Well, he's had this match at his mercy a few times today. He'll never get a better chance than this. I'm not saying to win it at this visit, but certainly to build up a very useful lead.
60.
Just a case of holding yourself together, forgetting all the mistakes that's gone. Just concentrate on the now. He looks on. He knows he's not played his best. His chances of staying in this tournament now are not dependent on him. Depending on what his opponent makes of this chance.
Certainty.
Well, the last two or three seasons haven't been particularly good ones for Fergal O'Brien, and when you get to this stage against the world champion, a chance to win, it is difficult. But he surely must be drawing encouragement from the shots that Mark Williams has missed. But he's just hitting the ball a little on the heavy side. And
24.
Just the wrong side of straight, I think, on this red to get through for the black. Now you see it. The red will go, but he could do with that cue ball another 2 inches to the left as we look at it.
Struck that nicely. Now there's one loose red, but really, as I said, I think in the last frame, now's the time to grasp the nettle, pot the blue, cannon into the pink and open up the reds. It's a frame and match winning chance if it goes right. You can't rely on your opponent making mistakes. It's time to make your own running. This could be the key shot to this match.
Well, John, you said it could be the key shot. I don't think you meant quite like that, but what a stroke of good fortune. How on earth did the blue get through there off a red, off a black? And perfect position to boot.
Well, if he has any doubts in his mind, that should have erased them. Because if I was in Fergal's shoes now, I'm thinking I'm fated to win this match. What a stroke of luck that was.
31.
I mean, on the face of it, when he misses the blue, you can't possibly imagine how the blue could get in the right corner pocket. It's impossible. It's got that big cluster of reds to get by. How does it get by them? Unbelievable. And perfect on the next red. And perfect on the red to get on the black. Amazing. But so many things have gone before Ray, and so many missed chances, that I don't think it'd be fair to put it down to one stroke of luck from either player, whoever had the bit of luck at the time.
Well, it's usually the case at snooker, John. You know, we do tend to say, oh, that was that fluke that did it, but most times you've probably missed the red, your opponent's missed the red, which you would never have got the fluke if he'd have got it, so it's part of the game.
44.
When you get it, though, take full advantage and 55 points in front. He's not far off the winning line.
Nicely on the black. Now, if he's straight, that's fine. He just screwed back to the right-hand cushion for the red in the right corner, for the red that's near the right-hand cushion. He's also had a look at those two reds that's near the pink spot, and they look very much as though they could be a plant for the right corner. This black to go 63 points in front, with a possible 75 remaining. But that's perfect. Just pop this black, screw back for the red near his hand. Looking at the scoreboard, he's looking at the black. It's perfect.
Yeah, I think he's just possibly a fraction the wrong side of straight. But he should be able to... Well, he can't screw back, he feels. He's going to have to run round. And where does it finish? Pretty good. Now, that's a good shot.
52.
This red and a black is all that's needed to knock out the defending champion and world champion, Mark Williams. A few years ago, Fergal O'Brien was ranked number 9 in the world. I felt his demise happened at the time when he lost in the Masters final to Paul Hunter, 10-9. It took him a while to recover. This victory could put him right back on track. And surely, 71 ahead, only 67 remaining. 60. And a plant, a cert plant, I feel, for the right corner. And this match, well, is it a certainty? One more red would clinch it. Mark Williams would concede, I'm certain.
That's the one, surely.
61.
And it has to be said that although he's had lots of chances, he has scored more heavily than his opponent and really could have won this match so much earlier. But he's stuck to it well, John.
Well, absolutely. I mean, in the end, that unbelievable stroke of luck on the blue has won him this frame and the match. But I think of the two players overall on the day,
66,
he's played the better.
Fergal O'Brien.
Yes,
66.
The concession comes and Mark Williams will be dreadfully disappointed. He fancied his chances of winning, but he hasn't been in his best form. All credit to Fergal O'Brien. Stuck to his task well to finally beat Mark Williams 9-7.
Yep, fearless Fergal, living up to his nickname there. But one of the most remarkable records in snooker has gone. Mark Williams had won 48 first-round matches, or opening round matches for him, and it was a record, Dennis, stretching back to February 1998. Reaction to that?
That's quite incredible, really. You can't see that record ever been beaten. I don't think Mark was even thinking about that. But what a remarkable piece of good fortune to eventually win the match for Fergal. But I don't think it was all about that blue. It was the 13th frame. Whoever won that was going to play a big part. And then when there were 7 frames each, that was a big frame. Mark doubled the green and landed right on the brown, 2 inches either way, and he would have been 8-7 in front. And Fergal, I think I agree with the boys, he really worked hard and he was the better player on the day. Mark didn't play to the best of his form.
What was missing from Mark's game, and what was the key for Fergal, do you think?
Well, Fergal's going to play that type of game. He's so difficult to beat as Fergal. He's such a fighter. And we heard him at the top of the show. He's very philosophical about the whole thing. And he's really worked hard to get this victory. And he deserves it because he puts a lot of practice in.
He does. Well, that's your reaction. Let's hear what the boys themselves had to say after that match.
Delighted and shattered, really. It's just a funny match, really, because it started off quite okay, you know. And up into 6-0, it was quite high standard. And then after 6-0, it was just dreadful, you know. The pair was like, it was like, you know, if you made double figures, it was like, that was a good break.
I'm getting a little bit fed up of playing like that in matches now. I've done it, you know, quite a few times, and it's only so many times you can get over the line. You know, I come unstuck tonight, and Fergal, you know, deserved to beat me because I felt he played a lot better than me all the way through, really. And, you know, I don't know where I bring up performances like that from.
When I lost to him in Brighton last week, I kind of said to myself, well, maybe it's meant to be that I'll be the one to break the record, you know. So, but having said that, there's a world of difference between the man to bet the man as opposed to being the man, you know what I mean? So to win 48 in a row was just unbelievable. I don't think that'll ever be beaten.
You know, it's a nice record to have. I mean, it was I was riding the wave for a long time. It was always going to, you know, come crumbling down, and now it's come down. But I think it's 48 or something. So, you know, it's an excellent record to have, and I don't think I'll be getting anywhere near that again.
Yeah, I'm going to have a full pint of shandy tonight instead of my usual half. Yeah, well, fortunately, my dad and a few pals have come over, so we stay up in it because there's no chance of me sleeping anyway now at the moment, so just try and relax. And thank God I've tomorrow off, otherwise I'd give a walk over. I'm shattered. But a day in bed tomorrow, and we have another go on Monday.
Day in bed, especially after a couple of shandies. Well done to you, Fergal. Right, our colleague John Parrott has been very chipper over the last month. You'll remember that he made it to the semi-finals of the LG Cup. And added to that, Everton beat Wolves today 2-0. So he hasn't been able to keep a smile off his face. However, that wasn't the case after the first session of his match this afternoon with Stephen Hendry, because he went in 6-2 down. But Parrott came out fighting this evening, reducing the deficit to 2 frames, and this is a very important frame that we're going to see now. Hendry, 30 points in front, Willie Thorne and Dennis Taylor keeping tabs on this one.
One.
Always missable. I think Stephen Hendry, Dennis, has missed more shots in this match against John Parrott than he missed in the whole tournament, the one he won a couple of weeks ago.
He certainly hasn't settled this evening. He finished the session off in terrific style with bricks of 73 and 128. That was this afternoon. But he certainly has been struggling this evening. John's had breaks of 70 and 57 in the first session this evening. Not an easy chance, this, the way the reds are situated, but that's not what he wanted. And he can't really go all the way around the table because the green's in the way if he was to do that. So he might just have to take the extra 7 points and play a good safety shot. I think that'll be his plan. He'll pot the black and try and get in behind pink and green with the white. And he's left the angle on the red just to cross that table twice, miss the blue, and 16. He could get a good snooker here. Well, he's just screwed off one cushion. I was surprised the way he played that.
John Parrott, 16.
Yes, and we know that Stephen Hendry is the very, very aggressive. Gotta be very careful here. If he misses this, it could kiss the red right over the other corner. Having missed so many easy shots, it's amazing how you can just knock a shot in like that.
Yes, and I suppose, to be fair, John Parrott should never have let him see that, because he's always capable of doing that, as Stephen. I think this is going to hurt John Parrott quite a bit, because that was a careless safety shot he played.
Eight.
Yes, we came into the session with Stephen Hendry leading by 6 frames to 2, and in fairness, of the 5 frames we've witnessed so far, John Parrott should have won them all. Lead goes to 31, so just one more red and colour. I believe John Parrott needing the snooker in 16. This frame. Seems 17. Virtually unheard of that Stephen Hendry could win 2 frames in the match without making a break above 40. Unless he makes 40 at this visit, that will be the equation. Made a 39 in winning frame 11. His high break in this frame is this now, 24. And it's also going to be the longest frame of the match as well. But that won't worry Stephen Hendry, because barring snookers,
over Stephen Hendry, who goes one away from victory at 8-5.
And that was enough to win the 13th, and the five-time UK champion went on to clinch it in the next one. Hendry, a 9-5 winner over John Parrott. Looks like John's back on the sofa with us then for the rest of the week. Let's hear what Stephen thought of his victory tonight.
John's one of the best battlers out there, and you know, he tends to up a gear when his back's against the wall. And I knew I was in for a tough time tonight. I knew 6-2, the match was nowhere near over. And in the end, you know, just fell over the line, really. The form's there. I mean, I'm not saying I'm playing bad. I mean, the form's there. I'm playing, you know, fantastically well on the practice table. I'm hitting the ball as well as I've ever hit the ball. But just sometimes you've got to scrape through matches. You know, it doesn't mean to say that's the way I'm going to play the next round. You know, hopefully I'm going to play a lot better.
Yep.